السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما بعد. Welcome back to the hereafter, the event of the Day of Judgment. Tonight, inshallah, تعالى, our discussion will be over the gathering. The gathering, or what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called Al-Hashr. If you remember from the last time we discussed together Al-Ba'th wa Al-Nushur, the event when Allah Azza wa Jal will give the command to the angel Al-Malak Israfil, who is holding to the horn in which he will be blowing in order for the everything to start again, coming back again to life. So when this happens, Allah Azza wa Jal says that everybody will be فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ will be قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ, which means they will be standing looking on. They will be standing looking on. And then the Hashr will begin right after that. So what happens when people start coming out? If you remember from the discussion last time, we said people will be coming out in layers. Basically, how the graves are, you know, they are sometimes the same spot perhaps would host multiple bodies, multiple, you know, dead people would be buried in that location over the years. So when they come out like layers. Their body will be perfect and complete. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the command to blow them into the horn again. And then the people will come out right now alive. Instantly, they will be standing up, looking around. So what happens next? That's when people, they come out, like when they were first born, they're naked, they're barefoot, carrying nothing with them. So they can hide nothing at all. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was very concerned about that. She said, Ya Rasulullah, وَيَنْظُرُ بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. Are they going to be looking at each other? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he told her, Ya Aisha, إِنَّ الشَّأْنَ أَعْظَمُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ أَنْ يَنْظُرُ بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَىٰ بَعْضٍ, that the matter on the Day of Judgment is much greater than even they're concerned about looking at each other. So they're so distracted because of what they are done, what they're going through right now, that they would not need to look into anything or look into somebody else at all. So then, the people will be looking at each other. And that's when Allah just mentioned Surah Yaseen, the dispute that will come among the people. قَالُوا يَا وَيْلَنَا مَنْ بَعَثَنَا مِنْ مَرْقَدِنَا. Ya وَيْلَنَا, woe to us, what's going on? We thought we were just sleeping. Is that a dream or what? مَنْ بَعَثَنَا مِنْ مَرْقَدِنَا. Who brought us back again, you know, up after we were sleeping? قَالْ هَذَا مَا وَعَدَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَصَدَقَ الْمُرْسَلُونَ. This is what the most person has promised. And the Mursaloon means the messengers, they told the truth about that. So how are they going to be resurrected? Hadith Muslim, in Sahih Muslim, rahimahullah ta'ala, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that every person who dies on the Day of Judgment, well, they will be resurrected on the same condition or the same status when they died. يعني يبعث كل ميت كل إنسان على ما مات عليه كل عبد يبعث على ما مات عليه. What's the meaning of يُبْعَثُ عَلَى مَا مَاتَ عَلَيْهِ? Does it mean that the person who dies in a car accident, he's going to wake up in a car accident? Does that mean the person who dies singing, is he going to wake up singing? Just like we said, the one who goes to Hajj and die in Ihram, they're going to wake up with Talbiyah. Is that the same thing? The answer actually no. The ulama, they said this means the status of Iman and Kufr. So if the last thing from that person was believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will also be resurrected with that belief in Allah azza wa jal. And those who died on hypocrisy, they also will be resurrected with hypocrisy, and so on. This is what's the meaning of كُلٌّ يُبْعَثُ عَلَىٰ مَا مَاتَ عَلَىٰ. They will be resurrected on what then? On the way, or the condition, the status, when they die. إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. So you don't die except as Muslim, so that when you wake up, when you are resurrected, also the state of Islam and submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the people, they stand up, they look at each other, okay, what's going on here? We are up right now. Suddenly, they start gathering towards one direction. They move on towards one direction. What is this direction that the people will be gathering towards? There were some hadith, although in terms of authenticity, some disputable, you know, narrations basically on the authenticity of this hadith, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that Ash-Sham Ardul Mahshar. Ash-Sham, the Levant, or the current modern day Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Palestine, these areas, is considered the land of the gathering. The land of the gathering. Is that the same land or not? The point is that everybody is going to be heading there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَحَشَرْنَاهُمْ فَلَمْ نُغَادِرْ مِنْهُمْ أَحَدًا. And we will gather them and not leave behind from them anyone. So everybody will be gathered on that day. Including the animals, they will be gathered as well, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And we mentioned that last week. Then what happens? So how will the people be gathered? First of all, the resurrection from that earth, we explained that, and then the station in the Holy Land. The station in the Holy Land, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that Asham Ardul Mahshar, means the Levant, or that area, is going to be the land of the congregation, the land of the gathering. People start heading over there. What is so special about it? Why Asham in particular? The ulama, they refer to Al-Isra wal Mi'raj. The night of Al-Isra wal Mi'raj, when the Prophet ﷺ, before he was sent up to the seventh heaven, where was he sent first? Ya Jama'a, where was he sent first? Masjid al-Aqsa, in Palestine, which is Asham. So what's the significance of that? The significance of that is that Asham is considered the station, the earth station, the earthly station to the hereafter, to the heavens. So if anybody is going to have an access to heaven, they have to come through the Holy Land, through that particular land. And that's why the ulama, they say when the Prophet ﷺ, he was shown the glory of the heavens, of course, it was just like an open escalator, an open like gate, that he can go through to go to meet his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, that magnificent journey, Al-Isra'u wal-Mi'raj. So Allah ta'ala alam, what happens is that the people, as they gather on earth, they will be moving towards that direction. So just like the earthly station that will take them and elevate them up to heavens. So they gather in Asham in groups, and then they will be elevated up to heavens. So the first congregation will be on earth, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that the resurrection is going to be from where? From the same land, from the same earth. He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, minha khalaqnakum wa fiha nu'idukum wa minha nukhrijukum taratan ukhra. That minha khalaqnakum, we created you from this earth. Wa fiha nu'idukum, we shall put you back into it. Wa minha nukhrijukum taratan ukhra, and we shall bring you out from that land one more time, from earth one more time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to bring us out from the same earth, and then from there, as we gather to Asham, we'll be elevated to the heavens for the actual gathering and the Hashr al-Azim, the great actually congregation. How is it going to look like? And where will the people be exactly, will be gathered? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give us too much description of the land of gathering, really. But what we know in the Quran, Allah Azza wa said in Surah Ibrahim, يَوْمَ تُبَدَّلُ الْأَرْضُ غَيْرَ الْأَرْضُ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ وَبَرَزُوا لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ. It will be on the day the earth will be replaced by another earth, and the heavens as well, and all the creatures will come out before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that prevailing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that they're going to be resurrected in an earth. However, that earth is going to be different. So what's the meaning of this? The ulama, they took this ayah in two meanings. There are two actually interpretations to this ayah. Number one, if this ayah speaks about the earth that we know today, when people are resurrected, it's not going to look the same at all. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he said another hadith, that the earth, as the people, as they gather, when they come out, you know, during the resurrection, the event of resurrection, the earth will be flat. And even the Prophet, he gave it actually a very vivid description for the people of that time. He said, just like the flat bread. For them, flat bread, not known to us. Not known to them very often. For us, it's the standard food that you guys eat, right? The paratha, the pita bread, and all that stuff, and so on. All the kind of different bread that you eat is flat. So the Prophet was saying it's going to be flat like a piece of bread. Like, you know, when you roll the dough and you make it absolutely flat and nice. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described that in Surah Taha about the earth. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْجِبَالِ فَقُلْ يَنْسِفُهَا رَبِّي نَسْفًا فَيَذَرَهَا قَاعًا صَفْصَفًا لَا تَرَى فِيهَا عِوَجًا وَلَا أَمْتًا. They ask you regarding the mountains. What's going to happen to the mountains on earth on that day? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised. He says, فَقُلْ يَنْسِفُهَا رَبِّي نَسْفًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy it completely. It will explode. It will be in a blast. And it will be completely, will become ash, like ashes, dust, and will be nothing. And then he described, لَا تَرَى فِيهَا عِوَجًا وَلَا أَمْتًا. The land afterwards will become a flat land. You will see no hills, no valleys. لَا عِوَجًا فِيهَا وَلَا أَمْتًا. Completely flat. So that's a description of the earth. So eventually, to Tubaddal, in that sense, that is completely different from what we know. You're going to have, inshallah, a chance for a question later. So there's another narration, there is another actual interpretation to this ayah, that this land, this earth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about here, is the earth in heavens. And some of the Sahaba, when they asked, actually, as a matter of fact, some of the Jewish rabbis, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as was mentioned in Sahih Muslim, in Hadith Tawbah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they said, Ya Muhammad, أَيْنَ يَكُونُ النَّاسُ يَمَا تُبَدُّ الْأَرْضُ غَيْرَ الْأَرْضُ. Where will the people be when the land will be replaced with another land? So he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they will be hum fi dhulmati dun al jisr. They will be right in the darkness, in that tunnel with the darkness, before they get to the bridge that crosses over Jahannam. And that tells you that's way after the gathering, and it's even way after the hisab and the account. This is on people's way to Al-Jannah and Jahannam. That means the land or the earth Allah is speaking about is different from the earth that we talk about over here. Wallahu ta'ala alam. So if it was the earth that we know today, which is most likely it would be actually, because Allah speaks about Al-Ard wa Samawat, the earth and the heavens, so that's going to be actually a completely different description for that earth. But it's still the same earth that we're living on today. You say, but Allah Azza wa Jalla, He will destroy that earth, right? Yes, He will. But He's capable also bring it back together in a different format, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Next, how long will the people wait in the land of gathering? So the people, as they come from their graves, they came out from their graves heading towards Jerusalem, let's say, or the Holy Land, and then they're going to be lifted all the way up. So their staying on earth is instant. It's not, they're not going to stay long. They will not stay long. They will immediately move forward. Immediately, as they move to the land of congregation or gathering, they will move up. So that is not going to last long. But then when they go up to the seventh heaven, they are going to stay there for some time. And how much time are they spending over there? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَعْرُجُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ إِلَيْهِ فِي يَوْمٍ كَانَ مِقْدَارُهُ خَمْسِينَ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ. The angels and the soul, the spirits, Jibreel in this case, will ascend to him during a day, the extent of which is 50,000 years. When it comes to time, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's an irrelevant matter. It is for us to recognize the length of it. But to Allah azza wa jalla, when you say 50,000, it's just like saying 50 million years. Because time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is completely irrelevant. He is Allah azza wa jalla before and after. He is the creator of time, subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. So this is only for us to recognize and see the length of these days. So when the Prophet ﷺ said that the people will be gathered there for over 500 years, waiting on that day for 500 years. So imagine, and these 500 years, they count in that fashion, 50,000 years each. What were people doing during that time? It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be an easy station for them. People will be just standing there, waiting for the account to begin, waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to start the account. What's the condition of the people during that station or that stay? That long standing, what is it? The Prophet ﷺ described that the sun on that day will come very near from the heads of the people. So the sun will come very close to them. And as a result, the Prophet, even he mentioned, it will be closer to a mile. But he used the word meal in the Arabic language. No, not mile in English, but it's meal in the Arabic language. And meal could be that distance. It could be the 1 mile distance. Doesn't necessarily mean the mile that we know it today, but eventually it's a distance, exactly. And the second meaning for the meal in the Arabic language is you know when you have the containers for the kuhl, or today like al-utr, the utr, the perfume. So when you open it basically, you know that stick that comes out, which is, it carries the utr or the perfume on it, and then you use it, that oil. That is called meal in the Arabic language. So see how short that is? It means it's going to be that close. So if the meal is this, it's going to be very close to the heads. You might say, but how could people survive that? We spoke about this earlier, that the people, when they come out, when they're resurrected, the nature of the body is going to be different from what we know it today. So they are going to be in this situation, this condition. They are going to come out in fear and panic. Fear and panic. They will be panicking, they will be extremely afraid, and there are so many ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the people and their panic. So their absar, their sight, their eyesight will be completely, they're so pale, and when they look, they don't even see anything. It's just like they're not focusing on anything in particular, because they're just, you know, looking into their memories and looking back into what they've done, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Nazi'at, قَالَ يَوْمْ فَإِذَا جَاءَتُ الطَّامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى. When the overwhelming event comes, which is the Day of Judgment. يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ مَا سَعَى. This is a day when the humans, every human being, every individual, will be remembering everything that they have done, everything they have strove for. So that's basically when you start remembering, your eyesight will be distracted. Even though you're looking at some in certain direction, but people, they can tell that you're not focusing, you're not looking at anything in particular. So that's the kind of the sense of it. So people will be just kind of standing there staring, and they don't really look at anything in particular, but it just in their minds they're trying to review and view everything they have done in their lives. They will cut ties with their loved ones. Now when people start trying to connect with each other, they won't even give them a chance. I don't even know you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described that in Surah Abasa as well, at the end of Surah Abasa, يَوْمَ يَفُرُ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ. That is a day when the person with his brother and sister, they will cut tie. The person with his parents will cut tie. With his spouse, your wife and your husband, you will cut tie with them. You will leave no friends at all. So people are now, basically, the event is absolutely individualistic, you know, kind of event. Every individual is concerned with his own self right now. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Maryam, وَكُلُّكُمْ أَتِيهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَرْدًا. That everybody will be standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Farda means alone, just by yourself. No one will be assisting you on that day. So cutting all the ties with the loved ones, the willingness to sacrifice everything to escape that fire. People are willing to even sacrifice their own parents, their own children, their own, you know, loved ones, so that they can survive and escape the fire of hell. Everybody is going to be doing that. Don't say, no, no, astaghfirullah, I love my parents so much. That day is so scary. On that day, you're not willing to sacrifice yourself for anybody. You're willing to sacrifice everything and everyone for saving yourself from Jahannam. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the people of Jahannam and the mushrikeen, the kafirin, that even if they have the entire world, the entire earth filled with gold, with treasures, what would they do? Laftadaw bih. They will just pay this as to ransom themselves from the fire of hell. Are they going to be ransomed? Of course not, because on that day, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا ينفع مال ولا بنون. No wealth, no gold, no money will benefit anybody. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Except for those who come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that clean and pure and sincere heart. May Allah make us among them, O jama'ah. The sun, as we say, would come so close from the heads of the people, that people will be covered as a result of that with their sweat. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described that event as people, they start sweating, of course, the sweat starts rising and rising and rising, and people will be covered in the sweat based on their deeds. Based on their deeds. You know, I mean, subhanAllah, summer is coming very soon for us right now here in Texas. And I don't know how many of you have lived enough here in Dallas area, but it gets humid sometimes, right? It's not like Houston, but at least it gets humid for us over here at some time during the summer. And subhanAllah, during the humidity, the season of the humidity, what happens to us, jama'ah? You can't stand your own shirt. You just walk out to go shopping, you know, for 5 minutes. You just go from the car to the store, from the store out to your car. When you come back home, you need to take a shower. You need to change your clothes. Why it's so sticky? You can't stand your own shirt on your back, subhanAllah. And that is what? It's not even a layer of sweat at all, nothing. It's just humidity and you just feel it sticky on your body, subhanAllah. Imagine if people, they're not just, you know, feeling sticky anymore, Allah musta'an. They're immersed in that sweat. So some people will be covered all the way to their ankles. Some it will go up to their knees. Some will be covered to their waists. Some of them will go all the way up to their chest. And some of them, as the Prophet ﷺ says, يَلْجُمُهُمُ الْعَرَقُ الْجَامَ. The Prophet, he put his hand on his mouth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like this. So he said, like, basically, they will be covered all the way to their mouth. You know, this is the scary part, right? This is now when you can barely standing on your toes, trying to survive. It's torturous. It's torturous. At least if you're covered, you can swim, right? But now you're not swimming, and you cannot stand even on your feet, because you have to stay on your toes, and this is very, very difficult. And this is what? It's not water even. It's sweat, jama'ah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some people will be completely covered. May Allah protect us all from that. So people will be covered. They will be covered in their sweat, again, based on their deeds, as an indication to what's coming for them. This is an indication for them. And for some, it is actually redemption. Which means this could be their own punishment. So then when they meet with the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, they've already been punished for whatever they've done. So they move on, inshallah, to safety afterwards. But again, you don't want to be in this position. Don't say, you know, Sheikh, if this is the case, I'd rather be in the sweat than being in Jahannam. You know, you don't want to be there at all. Don't even wish for that. Don't even try to think that I'm accepting this. You should not be even accepting that at all. Of course, when people, they will be standing there so long, all what they're going through right now is sorrow and grief. They will be crying, they will be whining, they'll be biting on their fingers, and many of them will be standing there in complete shock and silence. Completely. Why? Because now they don't know what's coming. They're so scared even to say a word. But that long, after a long stay, subhanAllah, some people will not be bothered by that at all. For them, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I don't know how many of you have been to Hajj, Jama'ah. But subhanAllah, on the Hajj, it's just like the day of the gathering, like Yawm al-Hashr, wallah. It's hot, it's sticky, you're sweating so much, and then whatever shade you can find on your way from Arafah to Muzdalifah, from Muzdalifah to Mina, from Mina to Mecca, any shade that you can find on your way will be much appreciated. Absolutely appreciated. And I remember those days, wallah. I remember sometimes we'll be walking, we'd be just walking by the side of the mountain just because there's maybe 1 or 2 feet of shade as we walk. Why? Because we've been walking in the sun for so long and so you can't even cover your head yet. And carrying with you an umbrella to cover you from the sun, it's not that effective either. SubhanAllah, it's so hard and so difficult. You will appreciate any kind of shade. And you know now, alhamdulillah, the system is mashallah being improved very well. So as you walk, there's those water sprayers, right? So when you walk, suddenly you have the water sprays on you, says, La ilaha illallah, like subhanAllah, it's coming from heaven, right? And sometimes as you walk, when the wind starts blowing, or even they have these engines, these fans, and blowing that air, you just feel like this is a breeze coming from Al-Jannah, Allahumma stan. And this is just in a dunya, in just few days event, in Hajj. Not even a few days, a few hours. That's the most difficult part of the Hajj part, basically. Just for a few hours, subhanAllah. Imagine if this is part of the Day of Judgment, and you're not standing there for a few hours or 2 hours, and it's not for you, there's no, the luxury of having shade is not given to anybody. So if you can find shade, it's not for you to go and take it. You can't. And subhanAllah, in the Hajj, I remember also seeing those days, when there will be some shade, limited space for shade. But guess what? You have 2 million people around. Do you expect people they're gonna leave that spot for you? They won't. So you look at them and you have a bunch of people gathered so much under just a small shade, in space for shade. And you look at them and say, oh man, I wish I can find a space. Even when you try to go and try to squeeze in, you have people pushing each other. Why? Because I'm sorry, I can't give you that space now. It's too hot for me as well. SubhanAllah, you can feel that even there. La ilaha illallah. But there will be people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant them shade. When everybody's looking around to look for a shade, and they will not be granted that shade. But some people, some categories of people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them that as part of the good news for them, and just to prepare them for his coming next of the bliss and the ni'am of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In one single hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned 7 categories. And these are not the only categories that will receive the pleasure of that shade. There's more actually. But these were mentioned in one single hadith. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, سَبْعَةٌ يُظُلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ حَيْثِ الْبُخَارِ الْمُسْلِمِ. That 7 of them, 7 categories, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shade them under his shade when there will be no shade but his subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, in a manner that suits his majesty, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 1, قَالَ إِمَامٌ عَادِلٌ. إِمَامٌ عَادِلٌ, which means a just ruler. Why do you guys think a just ruler deserves that shade? Why? What is so special about him that he would deserve that shade? Huh? Because he is responsible for so many people under him. A ruler, he is responsible for so many people under him. So if he was fair and just, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves justice. And part of this, that because he made it easy for the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to live their lives, Allah will make his life easy for him on the Day of Judgment. That just ruler, he makes life easy for the people. And as a result, Allah will make his life easy on the Day of Judgment. Now, don't try to be in that position, though, because it's not easy for you to be a ruler. The fitna of the position is so scary. So may Allah protect you from that. The second, a young person, رَجُلٌ أَوْ شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, شَابٌ, which means a young man, a young person. It also includes a young woman. نَشَأَ فِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ, grow up worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, I receive a lot of questions from people who come to me after they became a certain age, and they say, "Ya Sheikh, you know, when I was younger, I missed so many salawat. I skipped 5 years, 10 years, 7 years, that many years of salawat, you know. What am I going to do with these years of salah?" Now, wallahi, for me, the question is, yeah, there is an answer for it. May Allah forgive them for that. But that what really bothered me the most is the fact that those years that you missed making your salah were the golden years. These were the golden years when you were deserving the shade under the shade of Ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. You missed it. The youth, all the way until you become all close to 40 years old. This is all considered, you know, kuhula and rujula. So when you are 15, when you are 16, 17, 18, 19, 20 plus and so on, these years when people, they expect you to be completely distracted with the dunya, but you are among the few, you are among the few who dedicate their time for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that person, Allah Azza knows how much sacrifice this young man or woman they've done for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. How difficult their life was trying to resist their whims and their desires just to stay on the path of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How uneasy it was for them to resist the peer pressure of their friends to come and join us in partying and all the stuff and so on. And they stayed away for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because their life was a little bit difficult in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give it to them easy on the Day of Judgment. And the beginning will be the shade of Ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make us among them a jama'ah. Number three, a young man whose heart is attached to the masjid. وَرَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ بِالْمَسَاجِدِ. A man's heart is attached to the masajid. Which means, every time a salah ends, what does he think? The next salah. Before he leaves the masjid, he looks at his watch to see when is the next salah is coming and where should I be so that when the adhan is called, I'll be close to the masjid. It's not like you pray the salah and like, alhamdulillah, at least I did my salah. Some people, they pray one salah, I did my duty for the day. The rest of it is just chilling at home. Some people, they pray the salah and they stay in the masjid for the next salah because their heart is so attached. They don't want to go anywhere else. It's better for them to be in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those people, whenever they travel, the first thing they look for is what? The bazaar, right? No, they look for the masjid. If you travel on a business trip, you guys, if you travel on a business trip or vacation, wherever you go, what is the first thing you look for in that destination? Ask yourself the question, if your main concern is the best restaurant, is the best services, where the cheapest maybe deals, all the stuff, is this what you're looking for? Or are you looking for the masjid first? So that you know when time for salah comes, I need to be close to the masjid. You might say, "Ya Sheikh, but when you're traveling, you don't have to pay in the masjid, right?" I know there's a concession over here. But to be attached to the masajid, that's a very unique quality. Even when there's a rukhsa for you not to come, you still would come to the masjid. Number four, two individuals, rajulan, tahabba fillah, ijtama alayhi wa tafarraqa alayhi. Two people, men, two men. The hadith says rajulan, two men. But it also applies actually to the women. That they're not related to each other. They're not related to each other. So there is no bond among them besides the bond for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. اجتمع عليه وافترق عليه. When they come, when they meet for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when they part, for the same cause, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even if this union is going to separate, it has to be for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. Today, many people, they gather for other than the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There must be some ulterior motive. They're benefiting from each other. They're benefiting something from the dunya, not necessarily from the akhirah. Not that this union is haram, but the one that deserved the share of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day is the one that was done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And finding that person that you should love them for the sake of Allah is very scarce, a jama'ah, very unique. So if you ever find him, subhanahu, if you ever find this person, hold on to him. That's what the Prophet says in hadith, Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala, إِنَّمَا النَّاسِ كَيْبِلٍ مِّئَةٍ لَا تَكَاتَ تَجُدُ فِيهَا رَاحِلًا. That people are just like 100 camels. You can barely find one suitable for ride. From every 100 camel, they're all good for food, they're all good for milk. They're all good for carrying stuff on their back. But how many of these 100 camels can you trust with your life to cross the desert with? This is exactly the meaning of the people today. You have a lot of acquaintances, a lot of friends. Today you have a number of friends more than than anything else in this life. You call them virtual friends on Facebook, right? People, they befriend hundreds of people. But how many of these people can you trust them with your life in this dunya to take you to the akhirah? That's the meaning of this individual. When you found him, you should actually attach yourself to them, inshallah, for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. Number five, a young one, a young man who's been invited to commit the haram. Rajulun, aw shabun, da'atum ra'a, da'atum mansibin wa jamal. Means she invited him to commit the zina. فَقَالَنِي خَافُ اللَّهِ. A young man who's been invited to commit fornication by a woman who's beautiful and she has the power. So she had the wealth, the power, the beauty, so all the circumstances are perfect to commit that sin. However, he says, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's wrong. I can't do this. So they know, because it's the desire, the nafs would follow that. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the people of Jannah in Surah Al-Nazi'at, وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى, that he forbade his nafs from following the desires. So this person controls himself, and she's also controlling herself, they deserve the shade of Ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also an individual who gives in charity, رَجُلٌ أَعْطَى, keep spending for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Giving in the right hand until that the left hand doesn't even recognize, doesn't even know how much he gives. I mean, how far you're both hands from each other? Not too far, right? But he keeps giving so much that the left hand can't even count anymore. Stop counting, doesn't know how much exactly this person is giving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means this person, he puts his trust in Allah azza wa jal, always gives for the sake of Allah. And finally, a person who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in private and his eyes or her eyes shed tears out of sincerity. Imagine, you know, it's easier to cry when you pray Salatul Jama'ah. It's easier. Because there are a lot of people around you. There is a lot of motives maybe that makes people cry. Maybe you're hearing somebody crying in Salah, you cry for their crying. Maybe someone next to you is getting affected by the recitation, you start getting affected yourself and start crying as well. But what is difficult and hard is that if you can be by yourself at night when no one is watching and you're reciting the Quran or making your salah and your ibadah, you're just sitting there at home by yourself, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the blessings of Allah azza wa jal, and then suddenly you are overwhelmed. You are overwhelmed by joy to be blessed by the blessings of Islam, by the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then you cry. Or you've been overwhelmed by fear and khashya. The fear and awe, the shock and awe from the beauty and even the dangers basically of the Day of Judgment even. So then you cry for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a person Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them that they will have that safety. Because they show fear, Allah will give them that safety on the Day of Judgment by being under the shade of Ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah to make us among those seven categories who will be shared under the shade of Ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah ta'ala, next week when we come back, we will continue with one important event that will bring the end of Al-Hashr, the congregation. And that is the long hadith of Al-Shafa'at Al-Kubra, the intercession. And that is when people now, as they stand there for so long, they don't know what to do, what is next, what's coming next. This starts going to the Anbiya, asking them to see, they seeking help from them to start the account. Let's see where we're going to go. Jannah or Jahannam, let's just move on with that. How the Hashr will end, and what is the next event, which will be the hisab, the account, will be our discussion next week, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, on Wednesday after Salat al-Maghrib. Wallahu ta'ala. Any question, Jama? Can you have somebody turn the light on, please? Yes. No. No. Absolutely. Of course. The question is about the change that will happen to the universe on the Day of Resurrection or Day of Judgment, actually. As a matter of fact, before the resurrection even. Is that change going to be physical change or metaphoric? So when Allah speaks about the collapse of the system and the falling of the stars and the destruction of the mountains and so on, is that something metaphoric or physical? Actually, it's an actual destruction. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described that in many, many surahs, in Surah Al-Takwir and other surahs as well. So it's physical act of destruction. So when the people are resurrected, the site will be completely different. The landscape will be absolutely different from what they're used to. Wallahu a'lam. Now, let me see if somebody has a question. Any question, Jama? Yes? No. I'm not going to go through this basically. Is it the protection? It's actually the shade. Because the Prophet says, يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ سَبْعَةٌ يَظُلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ Seven will be under the shade of Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, when there will be no shade but His, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, I said in a manner that suits His Majesty. In a manner that suits His Majesty. Some of the ulama, they say that's the shade of Al-Arsh. That's the shade of Al-Arsh. Because there's another narration that brings Al-Arsh into it. But wallahu ta'ala, the expression of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah is that that's the shade of Ar-Rahman, the shade of the most merciful, in a manner that suits His Majesty. Wallahu a'lam. Of course, it does entail protection, safety, reward, and so on, bliss. But it's not, the shade is different than the protection, is different than the safety, different than the bliss that they're going to be in. Wallahu a'lam. Now, yes. Yes. They will be destroyed. There will be only one when they come back. Wallahu a'lam. Nah. Sisters, any question? Yes. Do we all have to go through the punishment of the grave? Actually, those who deserve it, they're going to have to go through some difficulties. But those who don't, they will also be enjoying the pleasure and the bliss of the grave. If you go back again to some of the presentations we had before, inshallah ta'ala, on the grave, we talked about that in details. What's going to happen in the grave? Some people, they will be punished for what they've done. Other people will be actually enjoying the bliss of being in the grave for the ni'mah and the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It all starts with the question of the angels, actually. So when the two angels, they come, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the people will be divided into like two categories. Some of them will be able to answer, and as a result they will be given the good news. And others will not be able to answer. Their answer will be like, la adi, which means, I don't know. So they have no clue what the answer is. Although the questions are very simple. Who is your Lord? What was the religion that you followed? And what do you say about the man that was sent to you, the messenger? Now, it's easy to give these answers, right? But when you're in the middle of that event, you become completely distracted. It's not easy for you to remember even your name, perhaps, at that time. Wallahu ta'ala. So may Allah protect us all from that. Now. Yes? Mm-hmm. Okay. The event that you're talking about is when people, they will be walking in the darkness, and then they will have light according to their deeds. That's coming as a stage. It's called this is when basically when the account takes place, people, they receive their report cards, they receive their books in their right hand, their left hand, and now as they move towards Al-Jannah, they're going to have to go across the bridge. This is where they're going to have that darkness. So this is completely different from that station. The station we're talking about right now is Al-Hashr. They're still coming out from earth to the heavens, and then now they're waiting for the account to begin. Once this is done, they're going to move on to that station later, inshallah. We're going to be speaking about that later, inshallah, azawajal. Any question? Hold on. No. Mm-hmm. The squeeze of the grave, as the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Qabr will squeeze, which means Dhammat al-Qabr, when people are squeezed in the grave. Is that for everybody? The answer is yes. And that is not a punishment, actually. It is just like the mother receiving the baby back again. Because we're all made from earth. So earth is really like Mother Earth, literally. It's like Mother Earth. So when you come back and you're buried in there, just like the mother receiving her baby back, you know, in. And that's kind of... Imagine when your mom doesn't see you for many years, right? In this case, it will be 60 years, 70 years, 50 years, depends on how long people live on this earth, right? So when you go back home and mom receives you, how she's going to receive you? Well, I mean, she might be too old to squeeze you, but eventually, if she has the power, she will squeeze you completely, just, you know, because she's a mother. She will hold her baby. So that's what the ulama, they interpret this actually, that squeeze. Wallahu a'lam. Now. Yes.
Standing in the field of hashr, and the sun coming through, and everybody is sweating, more or less, is it hot in the
No, of course not. We said that there are seven people that are exempt actually from that. So those who are exempt, they're not gonna, not everybody gonna be in the sweat. Those who are gonna be rewarded, they're not gonna be in there. Naam, wallahu ta'ala. Naam, khair inshallah ta'ala. Next week we will continue bin Allah Azza wa Jal with the final event of Al-Hashr, and then we start with the accounts. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.